Isaiah chapter number 9, and I'll just read one verse of scripture today. Isaiah chapter number 9, I want to read verse number 6. Isaiah chapter 9, verse number 6.
Amen.
I found that there's more there than what we preached this morning, so I thought I'd just get another shot at it.
Amen.
We preached this morning from this verse. But that's all right. I can never exhaust it. Nor could we exhaust the love of God.
Amen.
He loves the world enough that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Look what this says with me. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon His shoulder. Am I reading right? The government be upon His shoulder, and His name shall be called Wonderful.
Yeah.
That's where we were this morning, right?
Yeah.
Amen. Philip even helped me there with that wonder of His name. And it is wonderful. But I want to go to the next word. And His name is a Counselor.
Man.
We've got several other there. The Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace.
Yeah.
But I want to just zero in on this word that Jesus Christ is the greatest counselor that ever lived.
Amen.
Counseling seems to be a big thing in our modern society.
Yeah.
We've got school counselors. We've got church counselors. We've got hospital counselors. We've got doctor counselors. Counseling goes on everywhere you look. But I'm telling you, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given unto him. I want to preach just on this subject about the greatest counselor I've ever known. Our Heavenly Father, thank You for the privilege to pray. And Lord, as we come to You today, we pray for this dear missionary friend. Lord, I pray that You would help him with his endeavor for the glory of God, to rescue young boys from the clutches of the devil. And I pray, our Father, just now for this service, Lord, You know what we have need of. I pray, Father, You'd meet our need in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And Romans chapter 15 and verse 14, the Bible teaches us that God's people are competent to admonish one another. That we can help each other if we would just get together and try to bear one another's burdens. And rather than trying to be a lone ranger or trying to do things all by ourselves, if we would go to each other. Galatians chapter 6 and verse 2, the Bible said, bear ye one another's burdens. Romans chapter 12 and verse 15, it says, rejoice with them that rejoice and weep with them that weep. Charity is that aspect of the Christian love that draws Christians to help one another.
Amen.
Did you know that that's what we were supposed to do? We were supposed to try to help one another as we go down this road. And you can help me and I can help you and I can give you counsel and you can give me counsel. But I want to tell you, friend, that nobody can give God counsel. And nobody, He doesn't need any counsel from anybody. Jesus never once called the disciples together and said, I wonder what we're going to do. Amen. He never one time did He ever get in such a position that He didn't know what He was going to do. No wonder the people marveled because He spoke with one that had authority and not as the scribes and the Pharisees. What is a counselor today? Well, a counselor is actually anybody that gives advice. There are some people that should be competent to give advice, but a proper counselor is one who has the credentials to give advice. Now, who has credentials? Well, let me tell you something. Your mommy and your daddy have got credentials from God to give you advice on what you should do in life. I mean, that's the first counselors we have, is a natural relationship between our mom and our dad. They can tell us what to do, and it's right for us to do what they tell us to do. And it's wrong for us not to do what they tell us to do. How am I preaching? Let me say, somebody else that's got an office from God. The pastor has got a right to tell you what to do. He's got a right to counsel you. I believe the Sunday school teacher has got a right to tell you what to do. But above all of that, the Creator has got a right to tell you what to do. The counselor is Jesus Christ. We listened to the preacher last night that said His authority comes from the fact that He made us. He created us. He breathed into our nostrils the breath of life that we could become a living soul. And if we do not ask counsel of somebody that God has ordained to be a counselor, we're at risk in the advice that we get.
Yeah.
Amen. I think Perry Mason could give you good counsel on questions of law, but I think Raymond Burr was a sodomite that couldn't tell me nothing. Amen. Left everything he had to his queer boyfriend. Amen. We got a country that thinks you're supposed to counsel people that it's all right to be sodomized. I'm saying we've gone against the laws of God when we do that. Teachers and instructors and scribes and Pharisees in Jesus' day, the counselors of Israel, they always built upon the teaching of somebody else. They would have what the rabbi said, what the Talmud said. But Jesus, amen, He didn't get His outline for the Sermon on the Mount off the internet. I want you to know that right now. He didn't go down to the Bible bookstore and buy Him some outlines. Whenever He spake with authority. The greatest counselor that ever lived. People perceive that. Matthew chapter 7, verse 29. They said he don't talk like the scribes. He don't talk like the Pharisees. Whenever he speaks with authority. People perceived that. And then they sent that time the temple mafia, if you will, to arrest Him. And whenever they came to where He was, amen, they went back empty-handed. And they said, well, why didn't you bring Him? They said, hey, never a man spake like this man. I mean, I'm talking about Jesus as our counselor. I'm talking about if we would listen to what He says and quit overriding what He says with what we think, we'd be much better off. Jesus, sitting in the dirt on the side of the hill, had more authority than the plush carpeted pews and seats of Moses' seat and the thrones that the Jews wanted to sit on. And I think today we've got people that sit in high back chairs, and there's the successors to the counselors of Jesus' day, Dr. Phil, and the experts on Fox News and the Oprah crowd. But I'm telling you, they're not even smarter than a fifth grader. If I want counsel, I'll go to Jesus Christ. He's the greatest counselor that ever lived. Gone are the Finneys and the Spurgeons and the Whitfields and the Wesleys and the Edwards and who preached with power. We've lost it, man. Would you agree with me? Shake your pinky little head. The church today has lost that old time power that they used to have. Counselors today, preachers today are void of Holy Ghost conviction. Amen. I love it when I see somebody begin to weep in the church service and tell me that God is backing up the preacher. I'm saying we lost it, friend. We've got these worldly counselors, and we've substituted fireworks or substituted games or bubble gum or popcorn from the old time fashion preaching of the Word of God. And we need to get back to it today. Our attraction today, y'all come over to our house. We're having a pizza party. Amen. Lord knows I love pizza. I like what Jack Wood said, pizza's. Looks like a biscuit got run over by a tractor trailer and a dog come along vomited on it. He had a lot of tact in his preaching. Am I telling it right? We got these spatial programs and spatial days.
Yeah.
Pop on our bus and get our popcorn. And we just try to coddle. Our mistake has been, instead of preaching people and telling people the truth, we're trying to get them. We're sinner friendly.
Yeah, right.
Amen.
Right.
Sinner friendly.
Amen.
Now, I'm a friend of sinners, but I don't want sinners to be comfortable in my church.
Yeah.
I want them to be convicted when they come in here. You say, well, you can always tell when a preacher's good or a speaker's good that he'll be booked years in advance. They told me Bill Clinton is booked 15 years. You always know he's doing right. How far in advance he's booked. I'm not booked at all. I'm available. Give me a call. BR549. 9638. Job described his counselors in the book. He said, you miserable comforters are you all. And I think about today, we've been so caught up with trying to get a crowd that we've turned our churches into group discussions or aerobics classes or weight loss programs or how to win friends and influence people or anger management or bake sales or facelifts. Amen. Live your best life now. The old preacher told me the best is yet to come when I cross the other side. Now, I'm getting to, got all that said. Glad that's off my chest. I want to preach about a counselor. A real counselor will instruct you. Amen. Jesus said this, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and everything else you need will be added to you. Now, if you would need counsel, I would suggest you go to a counselor. I really would. Amen. You know, if I had a problem with my automobile, I would not go to Macy. Macy thinks she can fix it, but I wouldn't go to her because I don't trust her ability to fix my car. Amen. If I had an electrical problem, I wouldn't go to Sarah. Sarah's not in the electrical problem business. I've got people here that I could go to, but I wouldn't go. If I needed counseling, I'll tell you the first place I'd go. I already said James chapter 4 and verse 2 or 1 and verse 5 says, if you lack wisdom, let him ask of God. In chapter 4 and verse 2, it said, you have not because you ask not. In Matthew chapter 7, verse 7, Luke chapter 11, verse 9, the Bible says, ask and it shall be given unto you. Seek and, amen, you'll find, knock and it'll be opened. Moses was a unique character. And so on this counseling, I want to talk about him for a minute. You know, the Bible said that Moses, God spoke to him face to face. He didn't have to have a mediator. Turn with me to the book of Numbers, if you will. And I want to show you this if I can. Numbers chapter 27. Numbers chapter 27. I'll start reading verse number 18. Hello. Are you back there? I hadn't heard anybody say anything for a bit. Okay, Numbers 18, verse 18. The Lord said unto Moses, take thee Joshua, the son of Nun, a man in whom is the Spirit, and lay thine hand upon him. And he set him before Eleazar, the priest, and before all the congregation, and give him charge in their sight. And thou shalt put some of thine, that's what my King James Bible says. Amen, amen, amen. You said yours don't say that, well then shame on you. Thou shalt put some of thine honor upon him, that all the congregation of the children of Israel may be obedient. And watch this, he shall stand before Eleazar the priest, who shall ask counsel for him after the judgment of Urim before the Lord. At his word shall they go out, and at his word shall they come in, both he and all the children of Israel with him, even all the congregation. Now, what I want you to see here is Moses is getting ready to go. God had the practice of coming down and talking to Moses face to face. But then he said, whenever Joshua takes over, Joshua's not going to have it that way. Joshua is going to have some of it, but he's going to have something to come between him and God as a mediator when he asks counsel of God. In those days, it was called the Urim and the Thummim. I give up. I don't know what that means. I just know that's what it was called. And what they would happen, Joshua, whenever the Lord would want to talk to him, Joshua would go to the temple or the tabernacle, and he would ask of the priest. The priest would consult the Urim and the Thummim, and whatever it said is what Joshua would do. Now, he made mistakes. When he took the Gibeonites in without asking counsel, are you listening to me? He made a mistake. Amen. Now, we don't have a Urim or a Thummim. You say, do we have any counsel? Yes, praise the Lord. We got something we need to consult in every decision in life that we make. And we make a terrible mistake whenever we do not consult the Lord, because his book is the greatest counsel that we could have in this world. From Moses on, counsel was by a mediator. Cloud would come down. The man God wanted to give counsel, the high priest would come in, and at the tabernacle, and communication would occur. And if they lost that, the Bible said they would lose their counselor. Hosea chapter 3 and verse 4, they'll abide many days without a counselor. You think about that. As in Jerusalem. I saw those Jews with that little black hat on, that black clothes, and them little curly locks, and rocking back and forward. Amen. Asking counsel. Amen. When there was no counsel.
Right. Yeah.
Amen. They turned their back on God, and the counsel walked out when they did that. And I warn you, my Baptist friend, that if you turn your back on what God says in this book, you're walking out on the counsel of God, and you do so to your peril.
Amen.
For those years and years and years and years, they sit there. Amen. They don't like us Gentiles at all. They don't even want us on their property. They tolerate it in hopes that Jehovah will hear their prayer. But I'm telling you something. They're not Moses, and they don't have a Urim and a Thummim. If they had something to ask counsel of God, it would be this AV 1611 King James Bible, and he would tell them exactly what they need to do.
Amen.
So let me go further with this. A counselor is like a lawyer. He's like an attorney. And he's supposed to represent his client. Amen? I think about they go to school for years. Lawyers do. Somebody said a man that represents himself in court has a fool for a lawyer. Because they go for years. They study laws that you never even heard of. They know about state law, federal law, civil law, criminal law, common law, case law, corporate law, and the counselor works for his client. You listen to me. He advises his client, and a counselor that is right is a faithful counselor. He's a just counselor, and he stands as an advocate for the defendant. And I'm saying a smart defendant won't even try to represent himself. He'll say, I'll let my lawyer do the talking for me. Are you listening to me? In the glory land, hallelujah, I got a lawyer. I got an advocate with the Father. 1 John chapter 2. I don't even take my case. I just say, Jesus, you handle my case, and my counselor will take care of it. I have an advocate, a counselor that knows both sides of the argument. Amen. He's able to negotiate with both sides. Say a Christian would violate 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and sue a fellow church member. Amen. Happens all the time in Laodicea. A mediator could negotiate some kind of a settlement between the two. You know, Paul said, hey, if you got a problem with your church, won't you find the stupidest, dumbest member you got and let them answer your question? Did you know that? Amen. We say, oh, I need to go to somebody smart. No, if you can't get along with your fellow, amen, you can't get along with your fellow church member, you need to go to the dumbest person you can find. And believe me, I got some of them. And I asked them, what should I do? I'll tell you what you should. Well, I got to go on. A counselor, a real mediator, knows both sides of the story. I mean, so we could negotiate between two different church members, amen, but we could not mediate between a man and a horse or a cow or a dog. You know why? Because we don't know what they're thinking. We think we do. Amen. Animal planets got so slick at it, they think they can, and they got that fatal attractions deal on there now that people thought they could handle it. We don't know, we don't have a cow's nature, so we cannot negotiate. I said a counselor knows both sides and is able to negotiate from both standpoints. What are you talking about, preacher? I'm talking about the Lord Jesus Christ is able to reach up and get a hold of the hand of divinity. He knows all about it, and he's able to reach down and get a hold of me, an old wicked sinner, and make an intercession for the two. Jesus is my counselor. He's also God's counselor. You said nobody could be God's counselor. He is. So what's that make him? In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He counsels himself. Before the foundation of the world, God asked counsel of himself. He needed nothing. He didn't have to ask anything because he was deficient in his knowledge. But he held that counsel that we might know the wisdom of the unanimous agreement in the plan of salvation, that God the Father would be the forgiver, and God the Son would be the payer, and God the Holy Ghost would be the administrator. And they settled it. And that's the way it is. And I'm glad I got him as a counselor. So I guess the final answer is still Jesus. If you got a problem, don't be like Joshua. He should have went over there and asked counsel of the priest. But he made a league with the Gibeonites. Don't be like Rehoboam. Rehoboam should have went over and asked somebody new. But he went and asked that bunch of young people. Yeah. Amen. Wow. And young people can't counsel young people. Right. Don't ask Saul. Man. King Saul, he thought he could go to the witch of Endor and get some counsel. Yeah. Ahithophel left David. He was a counselor for David. But he left David because he was an unfaithful counselor. And I say this. Jesus said, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. There's a lot of problems in the world. But I tell you, the greatest counselor that ever lived is Jesus Christ. Many years ago now, probably close to 40 years ago, I used to listen to a radio broadcast called Back to the Bible. In those days, there was a preacher on there. His name was Theodore Epp. And Brother Epp's done gone to heaven. But he gave me this poem. And I just think for somebody that's in need, and you need a counselor, I think that I could share this with you. Maybe it'll bless you. It's blessed me for 40 years. Listen while I read this. Hast thou been hungry, child of mine? I too have needed bread. For 40 days I tasted not, till by the angels fed. Hast thou been thirsty? On the cross I suffered thirst for thee. I have promised to supply thy need. My child, come unto me. Perhaps thy way is weary oft, thy feet grow tired and lame. I wearied when I reached the well, I suffered just the same. When I bore the heavy cross, I struggled neath that load. And so I promise rest to all who walk the weary road. Does Satan sometimes buffet thee and tempt thy soul to sin? Do faith and hope and love grow weak and doubts and fears within? Remember, I was tempted thrice by that same foe of thine. He could not resist the word nor conquer power divine. When thou art sad and tears fall fast, my heart goes out to thee. For I wept over Jerusalem, the place so dear to me. When I came to Lazarus' tomb, I wept, my heart was sore. I will comfort thee when thou dost weep, till sorrow all is o'er. Do hearts prove false when thine is true? I know that bitter dart. I was betrayed by one I loved. I died with a broken heart. I loved my own, they loved me not. My heart was lonely too. I'll never leave thee, child of mine. My loving heart is true. Art thou discouraged in thy work? Does memory seem misery seem vain? I ministered midst unbelief with those of greed, of gain. They would not hearken to my voice, but scoffed with one accord. Your labor never is in vain, if done unto the Lord. So have courage then, my faithful one, I suffered all the way. Thy sensitive and loving heart I understand today. Whate'er thy grief, whate'er thy care, just bring it unto me. Yea, in the day of trouble call, I will deliver thee. Amen. That's my counselor.
Amen.
I hope he's yours. Amen. Let's bow for prayer.
Into the tent where a gypsy boy lay, dying alone at the close of the day. News of salvation we carried, said he. Nobody ever has told it to me. Tell it again. Tell it again, salvation story, repeat o'er and o'er, till none can say of the children of men, nobody ever has told me before.
Amen, amen.
Did he so love me, a poor little? Send unto me the good tidings of joy. Need I not perish, my hand will he hold. Nobody ever the story has told. Tell it again, tell it again. Salvation story repeat. Say of the children of men, nobody ever has told me before. Bending we caught the last words of his breath, just as he entered the valley of death. God sent his son, whosoever, said he. Then I am sure that he sent him for me.